All right, today we'll do the muscles of the lower limb. We'll start with the pelvis region. Here's a superior view of the pelvis, and looking down onto it, this is a region called the pelvic floor, created by mostly muscles from here. And one of the main muscle groups that make the pelvic floor include the levator ani. Muscle group, I guess for the whole floor, basically as an action, they support the pelvic viscera. Okay, they don't move joints or anything. These are muscles that support pelvic viscera. So that's kind of their quote unquote action. It's pretty easy. And the levator ani muscle group include three muscles, which are the pubofrontalis, which are the pubococcygeus, and iliococcygeus. So let me start to point those out to you. Puborectalis. Now, I'm starting with one that's actually not shown on a lot of models or apps like this one, but the name of the muscles are named for their attachments. Okay. That being said, I never really ask you where these muscles attach, so you don't have to worry about that. Actually, yes, you do, because how are they named? For their attachment, so that's why I don't ask you that. If you know the name, you know where it attaches. This attaches to the pubis and the rectum. Now, do you see a hole there? If you see the hole, that would be for the rectum, the end of the digestive tract. But let me kind of draw. The fibers just go anteriorly from the pubis. That's where I'll start. And the fibers run. Hold on. Go. There we go. And they wrap around the rectum and go like that. That's it. That's the muscles that, the muscle fibers that do that, that's that muscle. Okay. Puborectalis. So if you're studying models and it doesn't show that specific muscle, pretty much how I would clue you in is that I'll put like a sticker right next to the hole. Okay, oh, he's going for that one that's associated with the rectum. Okay, a good picture of it is on page 246. Puborectalis. The next one is pubococcygeus.
On 246.
That is correct, 246. And also, do you remember what the coccyx is, the tailbone? Let me just highlight it. Pull back a little bit. There's the one on the right side. It's highlighted. It's going anteriorly from the pubic bone, posteriorly to the coccyx. So just be able to identify that muscle. And the last one, iliococcygeus. highlight it right there. That's what it looks like in the pelvic floor. The one thing I always look for when I try to identify it for this one, there's this very noticeable tendinous arch right there. That seems to be very prominent no matter where it's shown, in a book or on a model, okay? And it's going from the iliac bone to the coccyx. So look for prominent thing about that. Well, those three muscles comprise what we call the levator ani. So know both. Know the three muscles and know the levator ani. Usually on a test, I want you to name the specific muscle. Sometimes students forget and you just put levator ani and maybe I'll give you a partial credit for that one. Maybe not. I don't know. I haven't decided yet, but no. Now, there's other muscles there besides those three, like there's this one there. That's the obturator internus. I'm going to present this again, but let me isolate it, say, on this side. I want to isolate it again because you can't see the tendon there. If I give you a posterior view, you see how the tendon reaches across and gets the greater trochanter there? So it's going to externally rotate the hip, so I'll present that again when I present the gluteal region. But consider it part of the pelvic floor too, obturator internus. An external rotator of the hip. Let's remember that external rotation, it's like when I turn my foot out, the hip is rotating laterally or externally. Okay. If I say lateral rotation of the hip, it means the same thing as external rotation in interchangeable terms. Okay, well anyways, getting back to the pelvic floor, you know, the muscle here. That be ischiococcygeus. On your study list. What's coccygeus? You know, coccygeus is on your study list. Hold on a second. Let me check something. I think that is coccygeus. Yeah, this app calls it ischiococcygeus, but your atlas calls it coccygeus, the one highlighted. But it does attach to the ischial spine, which makes sense why this app calls it ischiococcygeus. Maybe that's an alternative name.
So on the test, we would say coccygeus instead of ischiococcygeus.
Well, I'll accept ischiococcygeus since this app calls it that. Attaches
the
issue to ischial spine and coccygeus. You know, if you call something, if you name something based on any book or thing that you study, you'll get credit for it. If I mark it wrong, I didn't know it was called that, you just show me your book. But that usually doesn't happen. You just get it wrong and you want me to accept it. It's like, can't you give me, I called it that. And I always tell you, find a book that called it what you called it and I'll accept it. That's what this class is. You can't call it what you want to call it. You have to call it what it's known as. And I teach you what it's mostly known as. And if there's an alternate name that it goes by, you can teach me something. But usually you just missed it. You just want the extra point. You're not going to go look for it. No, it's not worth the point. There's one more muscle here. That's that one. That's called the piriform. That's a big one. Piriform is what I talk about a lot today. That's another one, if I give you a posterior view. It's exiting the pelvis, and it's going to rotate the hip too.
also forms part of the pelvic floor there, piriformis. Part of the pelvic floor, also an external rotator of the hip. Okay, so that's pelvic floor.
Did you say it exits?
Don't worry about that. I'm going to talk about it again on how it exits and all that stuff. You'll get it next time when I get to the gluteal region. Now, so that's pretty much all you have to know. I'm not going to ask you innervation either. I just don't for these. Okay. Other ones I will. Like, for example, the next group, muscles of the perineum. Let's do the perineum. Like, if I show you that, okay, without anything else. That's the perineum. Imagine your buttocks and thighs are there. The perineal region is the region between the thighs and the buttocks. It's pretty much where the external genitalia would be. Okay. Perineum. Well, let me just kind of leave this and reset. On skin. Right there. So, like, you kind of trace it. Perineal region, pretty much there. As a region. We'll talk about some muscles here. Those small bike seats. The area of your body that touches the bike seat, that's the perineum. Region between thighs and buttocks. Okay, so we'll talk about the muscles here. Let's see here, what do I got? So I got deep and superficial transverse perineal. So let me get rid of my pen. Clear. Skin off. There are superficial transverse perineal muscle. Let me isolate. It's a thin band. So, as a region, we're talking about something called the urogenital diaphragm. Urogenital diaphragm within the perineum. The urogenital diaphragm, diaphragm means membrane. Keep saying that. I'll remind you, in this case, the diaphragm is mostly muscle. And this diaphragm, it supports canals that exit the body. So basically I'll say supports urogenital canals. I mean basically it's urethra and vagina in women. Urethra in men and women, vagina only in women. So let me show you the whole thing. Let me just put it back in there. see if I can turn off a muscle there. Let's see, a little better. But it doesn't help. So what we're talking about, these two bands here, I just showed you one. The one on top is the superficial, okay? That's the bulb of the penis, so the urethra would be in there, okay? So know the deep and superficial, they're both presented as bands. There's the deep one, one isolated. So they both look the same, just as bands. Now usually, the deep transverse perineal, let me write them both here, as part of the UG diaphragm. Superficial and deep transverse perineal muscles. The deep one sometimes looks like a band, sometimes it looks like a muscle, depending on what you're studying. Okay, I've always known it to be more like a muscle that's a membrane, not a band. Okay, so let me see the deep one. Sometimes it's presented as a band, or sometimes it looks like a complete membrane. Now in the female model, they usually look more like a full-on membrane, not just a thin band like that. Let me show you the difference there. Female pelvis. Let me turn off the integument. Well, anyways, I'll leave the integument on. So if you look, this is pretty much the perineum with some skin on. The wife of an obstetrician, that's all they see. There's the two urogenital canals, that's vaginal canal, and that's urethra. So if I remove that, we can see superficial and deep transverse perineal muscles right underneath it. Turn that off. Okay. See, what's highlighted is the deep transverse perineal. It's not just a thin band, it's everything that's highlighted there, that's why I say more like complete membrane sometimes. So you've seen it both ways here. So know those two. Because
would that be a way to tell that the female or male?
No.
Or membrane?
I don't know, because I haven't dissected it enough to see. I would mostly see it this way. Okay. And on our male models, I usually see it this way, male or female, okay? That's what I'll expect. Only this app shows it as a thin band. I usually don't see it that way.
So on the lab practical, would we just say perineal muscle or complete membrane?
Oh, call it the deep transverse perineal muscle. I'm just complete member, I'm just trying to describe what it looks like. That's it. All right, I'm gonna move on from this. There's two more muscles in this area I'd like to do, and I'll leave it right here. The next muscles I want to present in this region are called erector muscles. They help maintain erection for the erectile tissues during sex arousal. Two erectile muscles are ischiocavernosus, bulbospongiosus. So this is a muscle named for ischium. refers to the ischium. Corpus cavernosum, it's erectile tissue in males and in females for different structures. Okay, so let me highlight the muscle. It attaches along the ischiopubic ramus there. There you go. That's the ischiocavernosus. If I were to isolate it, that's it. It just attaches to the pelvis right there. Okay. If I were to hide it, you see what it overlies. Let me throw in urogenital. So I have a highlight. I'm hiding the muscle. Now, hide it. You see what it does? It wraps a structure called the crust of the clitoris. Okay, I'm going to unhide it. Here it is. It's wrapping that. So in females, this muscle wraps the crust of clitoris. The clitoris is erectile tissue in females. Erectile tissue during sex arousal, the tissues become engorged with blood. Okay. And crust means leg. So it wraps around that. Again, we'll hide it one more time. So what I have highlighted is the crust of clitoris. Okay. So there's the muscle back there again. So you have two crusts of clitoris, and then they merge to form the body of clitoris and glans clitoris. You'll learn that in 431 when we go over repro. Now I just want you to know the muscle. There's another muscle here, and it's right there. Okay, it's called the bulbospongiosus. The bulbospongiosus. So in females, this muscle wraps around a structure called the vestibular bulb. Makes sense, right? Bulbospongiosus. So during sex arousal, both of these things, what they do is the muscles for ischiocavernosus, if you contract, it's like you're squeezing blood and keeping it in the crust of the clitoris. Contracts. Squeezing blood into clitoris. The other one, the bulbospongiosus, when that muscle contracts, the vestibular bulb, which is engorged with blood, is compressed. And when it compresses, there's a gland right next to it. And that gland is compressed by the bulb. And it secretes lubrication into the vestibule. Well, okay, let me hide it and show you these two things. So there's two things here. I don't know if you can see it. You should. That big thing is the vestibular bulb, the thing you just wrote down. So when it becomes engorged with blood and bulbospongiosus squeezes it, it compresses this gland called the greater vestibular gland, and it secretes lubricant right into the vestibule. The vestibule is the area, the space in front of the vaginal canal. So that's what happens there. So bulbospongiosus contracts. When it does so, it compresses vestibular bulb, which is erectile tissue. It's not a gland. It's erectile tissue. Vestibular bulb, which in turn compresses the greater vestibular gland. Then secretes into
the vestibule, which is basically the area in front of vaginal orifice. Okay, so be able to identify the muscle, know the function. And if you take me for 431, you get the exact same thing when we do repro. Obviously, it's a part of that lecture too. Okay, any questions on these two erector muscles? I did female, so it's like when I do repro, I got to teach it twice because there's another gender. Yeah.
The bulbous meningeal system is the muscle where laceration of degrees 1 through 4 takes place for vaginal birth.
Lacerations for what?
For vaginal birth.
Yeah.
It's usually lacerations.
You mean like an episteotomy?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they cut the labia. I don't know if they cut that muscle. I'd have to look that up. Now, he was asking about episteotomy where they assist the vaginal birth. If you can't get the baby's head through. There's a picture of that in the book, too. Yeah. I don't think they would want to. It's pretty deep. But I guess that could be damaged. But there's a picture of that. Let me see if I can find it real quick. Childbirth is brutal. Oh yeah. Page 261 has a picture of what you're talking about. Episteotomy. Let me see there. Perineal skin. Perineal laceration. Yeah, they don't mention anything about lacerating that muscle. Okay. We could probably look that up further. Answer your own question, maybe, I don't know. Okay. All right, let's do male. Let's see here. Well, oh, by the way, for male and for female, these muscles are innervated by the pudendal nerve. I do want you to know that nerve. Pudendal nerve. Innervated by pudendal nerve. Now, the pudendal nerve, there's an old saying in anatomy, the nerve roots for that nerve are S234, the sacral spinal nerves, S234. The old saying goes, when I talk about the males, you'll get it, S234 keeps your penis off the floor because they help maintain erection. Now, some people call it, it's kind of funny, but that's how I remember it. I always remember to teach that. I didn't come up with it. It's an old saying in anatomy. What was the other one I gave you? C345, keep your diaphragm alive. What nerve was that?
Phrenic,
yeah, it innervates the diaphragm. Let's do these two same muscles for male.
So does that nerve innervate the
Eugene?
Superficial also?
Yeah.
All four of them?
Yeah, this whole region.
Okay.
The pudendal nerve. Highlight there, you should be right there. Yeah, superficial branch of, it's pudendal. There's pudendal nerve. The pudendal nerve is in purple and it gives up all these branches. It goes to this region basically.
That's where the
All right, so I'm going to pull back a little bit. We're going to go to the male structure. So now we're in the male region. I'll turn off your genital. So we can see the erector muscles there. You turn off the nerves too. Can you see if I have a preset picture of this? No, I don't have it. I'm going to highlight one muscle here. This is, well, let's do ischial cavernosus first, since I did that first last time. So I'm going to highlight it and then isolate it on one side. Here's ischial cavernosus for the male. It's in the same location.
Is it laying on the bone? Is it laying on
Yeah, it's attached to the bone.
Yeah.
But hence the name. Yeah. So it's attached to the pelvis. So in males, this is the part, this muscle wraps the crest of the penis. Change those words to penis. Contract squeezing blood into that. Same function. So this is the part of the penis that's attached to the pelvis. It's the part you can't see. So let me throw in urogenital. Let me get rid of that. Hide that. Just trying to show you the muscle. So there's the muscle we're talking about. There's a lot going on here, but what I'm trying to show you is, let me just say it. This muscle, it only wraps around the root of the penis, okay? Not the whole penis, just at the root. The part you can't see. Okay, it doesn't wrap the whole thing, is what I'm trying to say. The other one is the bulbospongiosus. It's right next to it. It wraps the bulb of the penis. Let me isolate it. Right there. It's right in the middle. Okay. I put it back in the picture. I'm going to throw off your genital. You can see it on both sides. In females, it wrapped the vestibular bulb. And if I don't know if you remember, it remained open. In males, it's closed and it forms the ventral aspect of the penis, these two muscles on either side. So in females, it wraps the vestibular bulb. In males, it wraps the bulb of the penis. Again, it's the part you can't see, the bulb. The bulb of the penis is kind of, it's closed. I'll say it's closed. So go back in your notes and for female, write open. And what's the opening for? The birth canal, the vagina. Okay, so in males, it contracts, it compresses the bulb of the penis. Help maintain erection. It basically, it provides expulsive force during ejaculation. Let me get rid of this and write that down. Now let's remember that in males, the urethra is shared for the ejaculate and also the urine. So during urination, this muscle helps expel the last few drops of urine. So the male penis, some people call the clitoris the female penis, but I don't think that's a good analogy. The male penis, you have the urethra, which is for urination. Females, you don't have that. The clitoris doesn't contain the urethra, so functionally the analogy is not good. But they are both erectile tissue. All right, well anyways, be able to identify these two muscles innervated by pudendal nerve. So I'm going to move on from the perineal
region. I think that's all I have to say about this for now. We're going to move on to gluteal region. So I'm going to do a posterior. The gluteal region, generally people know, but in an anatomy book, pretty much just highlighted to one side, you just follow it up to the superior aspect of the ilium, right around there, and you just all the way down to the cleft of the buttock. But that's pretty much what an anatomist would call the gluteal region. Interested in the musculature. There's a lot of muscles there. Most superficially, after you remove all the fat and the fascia, that is the gluteus maximus. So this muscle is named for two reasons. One, the region. Another one, size. There's also medius and minimus. So relatively, this one's the largest. It has a lot of attachments, so let me show you. So the origins here in this reddish color basically has attachments on the external surface of the ilium, the sacrum, and the coccyx. It originates. Picture there, and it's going to attach to the hip bone, or it's going to the femur bone right there. That's the gluteal tuberosity in blue. That's one of the insertions. That's the bony insertion. You know, most of the muscle actually inserts onto a connective tissue structure called the iliotibial tract. Or, I call it IT band for short, you can call it that. Let me show you too. It's a connective tissue structure, it provides lateral support to the thigh and knee. It's highlighted now. Well, that's it. Okay, so no IT band. The IT band is part of a connective tissue structure called the fascia lata. Okay, so the fascia lata is all the connective tissue that wraps the entire thigh. The IT band is just the lateral part of that. That's the thickening of that fascia lata. Let me write that term down. Part of the fascia lata. Fascia lata that wraps thigh. I don't want you to think only thigh has fascia lata. There's fascia that wraps your whole body. The IT band is part of that fascia lata for the thigh. IT band is specific to that thigh. Let me see. Yeah, this app does a pretty good job. The fascia lata, it's like colored green. I don't know if it projects for you. You can barely see it. Well, just take my word for it, it wraps the whole thigh. Okay, so let me go back to the gluteal muscle. Let's talk about some of its actions. The main action is extension of the hip. That's the main one. You could say extend thigh, extend hip. You always name the region that's moving or the joint that's moving, the hip joint. Okay, either way is fine. I know what you mean if you say extend thigh, extend hip. Well, what you can't say is it extends the leg. Now, why would that be incorrect on an anatomy test? Is that the leg is not moving.
Right.
You'd have to be talking about the knee if the leg was moving. So yeah, don't make that mistake. But this muscle also can laterally rotate the hip. Thigh or hip, however you want to put it. You extend the thigh. So this muscle is mostly used like, you know, when you climb stairs or running. Okay. When running. Climbing stairs. And the innervation is a nerve called the inferior gluteal nerve. Let me show you the medius and minimus. There are some differences between these muscles. I'll put it back in the picture. Reset. On a model, always look for the medius right above the maximus. See it there? And see how it's partially covered by the maximus? Those vertical fibers is pretty much going all the way to the superior border of the ilium. If I isolate it so we can get a better look, that's what it looks like. That's the gluteus medius. So I'm just going to change my notes here. Change that to medius. It's pretty much originating just on the sacrum. Erase that. It's going to insert mostly on, well, entirely on that. That's the greater trochanter. Is that the greater trochanter? The actions are different. It medially rotates the hip, so I'll change that to medial. So you can say lateral rotation of the hip or external rotation of the hip, or you could say medial rotation of the hip or internal rotation of the hip. So it does that, it does the opposite. It doesn't really, I guess it could extend the thigh, it's not very good at it. What it really does during walking, it prevents the other side of the pelvis from sagging when it contracts. Keeps the pelvis horizontal. Prevents pelvis sag. On opposite side. We'll look at this later, but pretty much you don't think about this when you're walking, but during your gait, during your normal gait, there's a part of your gait where one leg is on the ground, the other one is swinging forward. During that time when the leg swings forward, there's only one foot on the ground. So the foot that's on the ground, these muscles contract. It contracts, stabilizes the pelvis, it keeps the other side from sagging. I don't know if you can picture that in your mind. It's like you're pulling here, the other side does not sag. Okay? If there was a weakness here, this would sag during the swing through phase of your gait. I'll show you an example of that later. Okay, for now, just note that the innervation is different. It's the superior gluteal nerve. Okay, let me show you minimus. It's different nerve roots, some of them are the same. The pudendal nerve is S234. Don't worry about the nerve roots for the gluteal nerves. All right, so let's remove some layers so we can see the minimus. There's minimus. I'm just gonna change that to minimus. It's deep to medius. Not a lot of models show it. Pretty much that big torso in the back of the room shows it. Students always ask me, well, where's minimus? You always try to figure out, oh, he can't test on it. There's no model that shows it. Oh, I'm good at finding stuff. It's on your list. I'm going to find something. Okay. In fact, if I hear you say that, it's going to be on your test. I love the challenge. Now, for the rest of the notes, it's all the same.
Okay.
So I'm not changing anything. Pretty much, I mean, attaches to the ilium, greater, it's all the same. Innervation's the same. So just make life easy, it's all the same. Okay. All right, so done with those three gluteal muscles. There's more in this region. The deeper region of the gluteal region has these external rotators of the hip. Yeah, both of them do. Yeah. This is a very common view. Like, if you work with this lower extremity model, if you remove glute max, you see this view. Like over here on this model. And there's all these muscles there that you do have to know. So let's go over them. As a group, right here, these are called the external rotators of the hip. Region. And before I go through the muscles, there's some connective tissue structures here. The basic idea of teaching this region, one of the reasons to study it is to study the muscles. Another reason is to study how nerves, arteries, and veins exit the pelvis to give supply for a blood and nervous innervation for this region. Okay? Because all the stuff, it originates in the body cavity, right? Because that's where your spinal cord is, it gives off the nerves. Well, your heart's inside the chest cavity, so all the arteries have to get out somehow, some way. So this is kind of where things squeeze out the back, basically. All right, so there's something called the sciatic foramina. And there's a good figure in your book that you should probably look at for this. Let's see here. Maybe it's in the lower extremity. Page 45, sciatic foramina.
45.
There's a greater and then there's a lesser sciatic foramina. Foramen is holes. So these are the holes where things exit out the back. So let me show you two ligaments that you've already noted, I think. I can't remember. I'm going to give it to you now in case I forgot to mention them previously. They are the sacrotuberous sacrospinous ligaments. They're sacrospinous. Throw on another layer. That big one is sacrotuberous ligaments. These ligaments help create the greater and the lesser sciatic foramen, okay? So let me highlight that. I mean, pretty much, use my 3D pen here. This is the greater sciatic foramen right there. It's the greater one, here's a lesser one. So that top one, that's the greater sciatic foramen. This bottom one, I'll put an L here somewhere. That's the lesser sciatic foramen. Those two holes. Okay, so the names of the ligaments were sacrospinous, sacrotuberous ligaments. They help create these foramen. Basically, I'm just writing them down. This is how things exit the pelvis. Okay, I'm also going to talk about the top one, the greater sciatic foramen. Okay. Now, the biggest thing that exits there is the muscle called piriformis. Add muscles to the picture. That's the muscle right there. That's the piriformis. You can see it exiting the greater sciatic foramen. This is a landmark muscle, okay? A landmark is, I look for other things around it. It's easy to find this muscle, and when I see it, I look for the things I know I'm supposed to see around it. You know, it's a landmark. And so, see how there's a little space above it and a little space below it? There's things that squeeze out above it and below it, okay? So let me show you. Well, let me tell you, then I'll show you. So there are structures that exit superior to the piriformis. I'll just say superiorly. Okay, write it under piriformis so you know later, okay, what's he talking about? Things that exit superior to the piriformis. They're superior gluteal nerve, artery, and vein. They all exit above it. Superior gluteal, the nerve, artery, and vein, NAV. They exit above it, okay, the nerve, artery, and vein. Sometimes they call it a bundle because structurally they're all right next to each other. So have you ever seen the term bundle? on a study guide or a test, it's referring to the NAV, the nerve, artery, and the vein. And what we know is that the nerve innervates the gluteus medius and minimus. Let me throw on nerves. There it is. Let me throw on arteries. There it is, and then the vein. There it is. So basically, I'm gonna zoom in on it. I mean, pretty much the yellow, the red, and the blue, that's what I'm talking about there. They exit superior to the piriformis. There's a lot of things that exit inferior to the piriformis coming out of that big hole. Let me throw in one more nerve layer. I highlighted a nerve in purple. The nerve I highlighted in purple is the inferior gluteal nerve that innervates glute max. So there are structures. Oh, I should have inserted the word exit. Structures that exit superiorly, you know, to the piriformis is the superior gluteal nerve, artery, and vein. Now let's talk about structures that exit inferiorly to the piriformis. Structures that exit inferiorly. They include the inferior gluteal nerve, artery, and vein bundle. So that's three structures referred to as one bundle. You also have the biggest one that you can't miss is the sciatic nerve. It's literally the biggest nerve of the body. It exits usually inferior to the piriformis. I highlighted it in purple. Maybe I should have just left it yellow. It's easier to see when it's yellow. It's about the width of your thumb. So the sciatic nerve exits inferior. There's a couple of other nerves that you should know. There's pudendal, I'm highlighted in purple. That's pudendal nerve. That exits there too. There's another nerve called posterior cutaneous femoral. Let me highlight that one. Posterior femoral cutaneous, excuse me, I mixed up the words. Okay, well, it's right there. Anyways, just list it as another one. Posterior femoral cutaneous. Posterior femoral cutaneous nerve. If the word cutaneous is in the name, is that a sensory or motor function? Cutaneous? Skin? Skin is a sensory function. You feel with your skin. So that's a good clue. You know. Well, anyways, they're all there.
Is that the same nerve that changes its name that we were talking about yesterday to the...
No.
No?
I don't think so. I did talk about an artery that changes its name.
Yeah, that's what I was talking about. Sorry.
All right, so the piriformis is important, right? Because all these structures are exiting above and below it. So I'm gonna turn all this stuff off and just get back to talking about the piriformis muscle itself. Let's isolate the muscle. There it is. It originates, it's originating on the inside surface of the sacrum, and it attaches to, inserts on the greater trochanter. So for these muscles I'm going to talk about, the first one is piriformis. I have a memory jogger that helps me remember this muscle group, PGOGQ, P-G-O-G-Q, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 muscles. Well, the P is piriformis. Okay. What these muscles have in common is they all do this for an action. So I'm not going to list actions for each muscle. They all do this. Okay. In terms of innervation, I just say they all have innervation by direct branches from the sacral plexus. Okay. They don't have all these named nerves. Innervation. Direct branches of sacral plexus. So for PGOGQ, action, all the same, innervation, all the same, just say direct branches of sacral plexus, just to keep it simple. So for piriformis, let's talk about the attachments. Look for that, okay? It's your landmark. What does it do? Look at the attachments. It originates internal surface of sacrum. And it's going to insert all on the, they all insert on the greater trochanter. Help externally rotate it. The greater trochanter, not to be confused with the lesser one, it has a lot of room to have a lot of muscles attached to it. Okay? So, we move on. Piriformis, let me tell you why it's named that. It means pear-shaped. Named for its shape. Then you have the GOG. So I listed them in order. Let me explain that PGOGQ real quick, just to name them. What's highlighted is the piriformis. That GOG is three muscles in one. I'm just going to point to it. It goes piriformis, gemellus superior, obturator internus for the O. The second G is gemellus inferior. Then the Q is quadratus femoris, the four-sided muscle. Okay, so let's do that GOG first. I'm going to highlight that next one right under it. There it is. There's gemellus, superior gemellus, isolated. There it is, isolated, superior gemellus. Its origin is the ischial spine. Just look at that, that's the ischial spine right there. Ischial spine, insertion, same. Greater trochanter. Let's move on. You know what the action is? You know what the innervation is? Okay, it's all the same for all. So the muscle right inferior to it is that obturator internus. Do you remember I talked about it before? There it is. You can see the tendon of it highlighted in yellow. Remember when I isolated it for the pelvic floor thing? It looked like that. That's the obturator internus. So really what we see in the gluteal region is mostly just this tendon. That's obturator internus. That's the O of GOG, obturator.
or the O, the origin, it originates on that obturator membrane. And what am I going to put for insertion? You should be on to me now. Same, it's all greater trochanter. You write it again if you want. I guess I better. I want to squeeze in that second G. You should know what it is. What is it? It's not the superior gemellus, it's the inferior gemellus. So I'm going over in order from top to bottom there. So there it is, highlighted. Let's isolate it so you can see the origin clearly. The inferior gemellus it originates on the ischial tuberosity. And it inserts on the greater trochanter, and I'm not even going to write it. I ran out of room on the board, but you should know by now. So don't ask me later, oh, so I don't have to know that? You always want to play that game, right? You didn't write it on the board, so I don't have to know it, right? No, you got to know it. So here's the G, O, G. Okay. Now, sometimes people refer to these three muscles as one muscle, called the triceps coxae. The GOG, also known as... Because cox means hip. Triceps means three heads. Okay, so know that term too. All right, the last muscle of the group is the quadratus femoris. Is named for its shape, four sides. As you can see there, isolated, it originates the ischial tuberosity and inserts on the greater trochanter as well. Originates ischial tuberosity, inserts greater trochanter. So those are all those muscles, the three gluteal muscles, maximus, medius, minimus, and then the PGOG, Q, know all those muscles. We're going to move on to a different region, the thigh. Pull back a little bit, pull the skin back on. I mean, you should know that the thigh is the area between the hip and the knee. Okay, let's think of the thigh in compartments. Think of the thigh. Thank you.
there's a posterior compartment, there's an anterior compartment, there's a medial compartment. Okay, so when you talk about the thigh, it's helpful for a student to kind of organize what you're thinking about. Think about the hip joint and the knee joint, because muscles from this region can move those joints. Think about the hip, think about the knee. If you're a muscle in the posterior compartment, like we're seeing here, you're on the back, basically. Okay. You can, if you cross the hip joint, not all of them do, but if you cross the hip joint, you could extend it, like glute max. If you cross the knee joint and you're in this compartment, you can flex the knee, right? Flex knee. If you flip it, now you're a muscle on the front, you can bring the hip forward, that's flexion of the hip. Or you could extend the knee as when you stand up from a seated position. And so, you know, that makes sense. If you're on the opposite side, you do the opposite. And students always mess this up. So I want to make sure it's clear from the get-go. Maybe you won't mess it up. Basically, if you're in the medial compartment, those are called adductors. They adduct the thigh or the hip. Some can move the knee. I'm going to ignore that for now. I'm going to speak in general terms. Basically, these adduct hip. Adduction, adduct. And in each compartment, the innervation is different. In the posterior compartment, it's the sciatic nerve and its divisions, basically. I'll teach what the divisions of that nerve are. In the anterior compartment, it's the femoral nerve. And in the medial compartment, it's obturator nerve. So each compartment, the muscles in it have different innervation. Let's see here. Talk about those nerves a little bit. Talk about the spinal nerve roots for these nerves. I guess I'll just leave that. From L2 all the way down to S3. So talking about not vertebra, spinal nerves. The level of L2 going down to L3, L4, L5, S1, S2, S3. You know, these two, the femoral and obturator, they both have nerve roots from L2 to L4. Obturator is this one, the green one. It's going to go to the medial thigh, right? femoral will go to anterior thigh using the same nerve roots. Sciatic nerve will take roots from L4 all the way down. Okay, basically, that plexus is two divisions, and I'm going to draw two colors to represent two divisions. The sciatic nerve is composed of a tibial division, tibial nerve, and what's called the common fibular division. I'll use green. Oh, I mean, I can use different colors. Well, I'll keep the same color so you don't get mad at me. Use the same colors. Doesn't matter. The point is two divisions, two different colors. So green, common fibular. So basically, together, they will separate when you get to the popliteal region, but when they're together, posterior thigh, they're wrapped together with the connective tissue called sciatic nerve. Okay, but those are the two divisions within sciatic nerve is my point, the divisions. So that's the innervation to the thigh. We'll start talking about the muscles. We'll start with posterior. Ooh, look at that, dermatomes. Cool. If you take an advanced anatomy class, you have to memorize that, I guess. Let's just talk about the basic muscles. The basic muscles of the posterior thigh are the hamstrings. Term used in anatomy, it's kind of, I guess it's a butcher's term. You see those like tendons at the knee there? Butchers hang the cuts of meats by the tendons of these muscles for the animals. You ever heard the term hamstring your enemy? Mm-hmm. You slice the knee back here, you slice those tendons, your enemy can't run away from you. Anyways, we still call them hamstrings. Most of them originate from the ischial tuberosity. Let me zoom in on that. Boom. I highlighted the sacrotuberous ligament. Where that ligament ends, you should see the origins of the hamstring muscles right there. This is kind of what it looks like on our model over there. So follow the ligament down. Oh, boy, I see muscles here. Oh, hamstrings. Ischial tuberosity, that's kind of where you are. Let's isolate one. Basically, keep this in your head. Do you see how the hamstrings, you're either gonna insert medially or insert laterally, okay? And students always mix that up. So if you can keep it straight, you won't miss them in terms of identification. Let's start with one that inserts the medial aspect. That's the semitendinosus. Let me isolate it. Posterior view. There it is in full length, the semitendinosus. Semi means half. So
this muscle is named for its appearance. It's literally half a tendon. The tendon's very long. See where it starts to turn white? That's tendon. It goes all the way down. It starts right there. Medial aspect of the tibia. It originates way up there. Okay. So, half a tendon. Originates ischial tuberosity.
It inserts on the medial aspect of the tibia via a tendon called the pes anser medius. I do want you to know that.
So this is a rare example where the tendon of the muscle has a name. It's called the pes anser medius. And it means goose foot. It's shaped like a goose foot. Can't really show that to you here, but you have to take my word for it. The tendon is in the shape of a goose foot. And it's shared by other muscles. So this is the first that uses the pes anser medius tendon. So let's think about what we're doing here. We originate on the ischial tuberosity, that's the hip bone, and then you insert on tibia. Let me ask you a question. Does this muscle cross the hip joint? Yes or no? If you attach to the hip, you do cross the hip joint. Okay, that's all I want you to think. Yeah, if you attach to the hip, that's on the hip, you do cross the hip joint. Do you cross the knee if you insert on the tibia? Yes or no? Yes, you do.
Yes.
Yeah, that's a leg bone. So you cross both joints, so you can move both joints. This muscle can extend the hip and do what to the knee? Flex lean. Yeah. Have you ever work out your hamstrings?
Yeah.
You lay it down, you do that machine thing. You flex the knee. Okay, so that's the action. Extend hip, flex. The knee and the innervation tibial nerve. There's a muscle right underneath this muscle called the semimembranosus. All the muscles together, I mean, look for it. It's right underneath there. It's highlighted now. It's hard to see. I mean, I think you could tell it's underneath the muscle on top, which is the one we just did, semitendinosus. Let's isolate semimembranosus, named for its shape. It's flat like a membrane. Flattened like a membrane. Semimembranosus. Same origins, ischial tuberosity. Pretty much I'll just leave a medial aspect of tibia. It doesn't use the pes anser medius though, so I'm just going to erase that. Pes anser medius is one of those words you'll only use while taking an anatomy class. But know that tendon. This one, just say medial aspect tibia, does the same stuff, right? Extend hip, flex knee, same innervation. Okay, so I'm going to leave that. Okay, let's talk about the hamstrings that insert on the other side of the knee, the lateral aspect of the knee. Those are the biceps femoris. So we got two heads to know. Here you go. I'm going to isolate the long head of the biceps femoris. Here's a posterior view of it.
get it in full view here on my app. It's starting at the same place, ischial tuberosity, except it's going to go to the lateral aspect of the knee. Long head. Of the biceps femoris. There is a short head, let's distinguish the two. The long head originates, just like all the other ones, ischial tuberosity. Let me rewrite it since I partially erased it. Writing it and rewriting it's very good. Some of you need practice spelling this, and write it 3 times each, 5 times each, whatever you have to do to get the spelling right. The insertion is head of fibula. Let me zoom in on that so you get a good look at it. Remember, the fibula is your lateral leg bone. There it is inserting on the head of fibula. Okay, so the actions are the same, right? And the innervation is the same, so I'm going to leave that. Okay, let's talk about the short head, because that's kind of the exception muscle of this group. All the other ones originated on the ischial tuberosity. This one doesn't. Look for the short head deep to the long head. Try to get it. Is that it? Yeah, that's got to be it. Short head, biceps femoris, isolate. There you go. There it is. It originates linea aspera. Does it cross the hip joint? That's a yes-no question. No, it doesn't. The hip, you know, I guess it helps to know what the hip is. The hip is the femoral head and the acetabulum, right? If you're like way down there, you can't move that joint, right? And that's the concept I'm trying to teach anatomy. A muscle can move a joint that it crosses. It can't affect that. It's like down here. Hopefully that's obvious to you by now. It can flex the knee. So I'm just going to erase extend hip. Okay. So it originates linea aspera, posterior femur, right? Inserts head of fibula, so it crosses the knee. It can flex the knee. The innervation is different too. Common fibular. The exception muscle. Okay, done with this region, posterior thigh. I'm going to move on to a different region of the thigh. I guess we'll do anterior next. Here's anterior thigh. It's basically 5 muscles, 4 quads and sartorius. Anterior thigh is 5 muscles, 4 quads, plus a muscle called sartorius. The innervation is the same, the femoral nerve, as I said before, serves this area for the somatic motor function. Let's do the muscle of the 4 quads. Now, the full name, quads is an unacceptable term for a test. The full name is quadriceps femoris. This first muscle is the rectus femoris, right there. Oh, I'm sorry, not right there. Where is it? Oh, I gotta add a layer. Here you go, that's it. Rectus femoris right there. Let me isolate it. This muscle, rectus means straight. This muscle originates not the anterior superior iliac spine, but the anterior inferior iliac spine. Now let me zoom in on that since I didn't show that to you before. Okay, that's its origin. That top one that you can palpate, top of your hip, that's the superior one, that's the inferior one. Anterior, inferior iliac spine. So know that it's going to insert on tibial tuberosity via the quadriceps tendon and patellar ligament. We showed that to you before. I showed that to you before in the knee. Hopefully you remember. If you've forgotten that, there is the patellar ligament. Ultimately inserts on tibial tuberosity via quadriceps tendon and patellar ligament. So go back and look those up if you've forgotten what those are. They're in your notes for the knee. And well, pretty much. We call this your kicking muscle because if you cross, you can cross both joints, right? If you attach to the hip, you cross the hip joint. You go all the way down to the tibia, you cross the knee. So you can flex, hip, extend, knee, as in kicking. Let me show you flex hip again. That one seems to be missed a lot by students on tests, the whole flex extend hip. Let me show you a motion. Here is hip flexion by the rectus femoris. Show it to you from the side. Okay, and the muscle lights up when the hip is moving forward. Now, this picture is showing two actions. You're flexing the knee with the hip in this picture, but the action I'm talking about is this joint right there. When you bring the hip forward or up, that's hip flexion. Okay. Here's extension. Not that. When you straighten the knee, that's extension. Straighten the knee. So I want to make sure that's clear. So the rectus femoris is the only quad that can do both, all right? The other quads don't do that. I'm gonna remove rectus femoris. I think of the other three quads as a hot dog in a bun. The bun is vastus lateralis, vastus medialis, and I guess the hot dog in the bun would be vastus intermedius, which would be underneath the rectus femoris. Okay, so vastus lateralis, right there, big muscle. Hence the name, vastus, means big. Why did they name this muscle
It's big. Vastus lateralis is a relative term. It's lateral in the thigh, right? That's lateral. Okay. No, the insertion is the same. I'm not going to erase it. Quadrant. Oh, I misspelled. That should be
an I, not an E.
Quadriceps, tendon, patellar, ligament. Same insertion for all four quads. That makes it easy. I would say for the origin, just say anterior femur. You don't have to be too specific about it. The key is that it originates on the femur. Therefore, does it cross the hip joint? That's a no. Okay. If you start on the femur, you don't start on the hip bone, you don't cross the hip joint. So you can't move the hip. You can only extend knee. That's why I erased flex hip. What's the innervation? Femoral nerve, that's the same. All right, so let's move on. Let's do the other vastus, the medialis. Okay, so everything's the same, except I'll change vastus lateralis to medialis. I'll leave the attachments the same, pretty much. Just front of the thigh bone, the femur, and just quadriceps tendon, patellar ligament. The action, again, just extend the knee. Okay, it's all the same for the quads from here on out. The other one that you don't see too much, you gotta remove the rectus femoris, get it out of the way, is vastus intermedius. Isolate that. Practice spelling intermedius. That's one that's common. You can remember it's inter something. Vastus intermedius. Okay, you want to say medialis, medi something. Vastus intermedius is the name of the muscle. Does all the same stuff as the other vastus muscles. Same attachments, same action, extend the knee. And that's the fourth muscle of the quads. The full name of the muscle group is quadriceps femoris, but there's one more. The fifth muscle is sartorius, a big, long strap muscle. There it is. I'm going to isolate it. Big, long strap muscle. Okay, that name is, it means the tailor's muscle. The origin is ASIS. I'll just write it to be brief. You need to know what it means, anterior superior iliac spine. Write it out on a test. Now, the insertion, it uses that Pezant's arenus. So it inserts on medial aspect of tibia via the Pezant's arenus. And so the name is for its action. When a tailor does the patchwork, some of you are doing it right now. If I sit in my chair, you're much better to do with my leg. I cross my leg like this. Now when you do that from the anatomy language, what are you doing? Oh, you do that. Yeah, when you do that, you can't put that on the test, right? When you cross your legs, that's not anatomy. What are you doing? You're flexing what? Hip. Okay. You can also flex the leg and you laterally rotate hip.
when you do that. So that's the action. Because when a tailor does their patchwork, I guess they go like, I don't know, do the patchwork. That's why the muscle got its name, for this action. Flex hip, flex leg. That's an exception to this group, right? Usually, if you're in the anterior compartment, you extend the leg. There's always an exception. Anatomy drives you crazy. So, remember it. Laterally rotate. Hip. That's always a test question because the muscle is named for its action. Okay, anything else? Oh yeah, well, let's pitch answer this. All right, that's it for that muscle group. Let's take a break and we'll come back. We'll finish the thigh and the rest of the stuff.